In a lot of ways, America is a strangely right-wing country. No universal health care, no universal child care, poor labor protections. Everyone knows this. But why is that? Well, if you look at American history, you actually find a pretty interesting reason. Unlike other industrialized countries, America never really had a powerful socialist movement. Compare that to Europe. In the 19th and 20th centuries, every country in Europe saw a huge socialist party develop. The Social Democratic Party in Germany, the Labour Party in the United Kingdom, the Socialist Party in Belgium. In countries like Denmark, Norway, and Sweden, parties with socialist roots governed for decades. Now, none of these countries ever became fully socialist. Instead, socialist parties and their allies built well-functioning social democratic institutions. It's what they called the European way. Universal health care, generous welfare programs, free education, and strong protections for labor. But that sort of transformation never happened in the United States. Now, to be fair, the US did see a fairly strong progressive movement in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. There was the Working Man's Party of the 1870s, the governments of radical reconstruction, which W.E.B. Du Bois called dictatorships of the proletariat, and the leftist Populist Party, which won 5 states in 1892. There were even 2 members of the Socialist Party elected to Congress, and in 1912, Eugene Debs, the Socialist presidential candidate, received a full 6% of the national popular vote. The American Socialists were successful enough that in 1906, the leader of the German Social Democratic Party predicted that Americans will be the first to usher in a socialist republic. So why did the American left never gain power like the European left did? There are a few schools of thought about this. The most famous view, that of the German economist Werner Sombart, suggests that Americans were too prosperous and wealthy to believe in socialism. All socialist utopias, he said, came to nothing on roast beef and apple pie. Socialism needed workers to live close together to form working class institutions. It could do that in places like Berlin or London or Paris, but not so much in sprawling America. Even as the country urbanized in the 20th century, it also suburbanized. Suburban sprawl promoted anonymity and atomization rather than the sense of community and solidarity that socialism needs to take root. Denser places like the Lower East Side of New York, at one point the most densely populated place on Earth, were hubs of socialism and radicalism of all shades. But the vast majority of places weren't like that. And the fact that there was so much land also meant that workers were constantly moving in search of better jobs. As late as the 1960s, about 20% of Americans moved every year. That rate of moving was way higher than in most European countries, and that central struggle, unifying and organizing a disparate working class, was made more difficult by a lot of other problems. Another source of division was occupation. Early attempts to form unifying working class organizations across different levels of skill, like the Knights of Labor in the 1880s, were destroyed by state terror and repression. There were also cultural and political distinctions that made building a party of the working class impossible. The fact that America had universal or near universal male suffrage at a relatively early date, decades before the United Kingdom, prevented voters from polarizing on class lines. That's part of why, in the 19th and 20th centuries, many of the most dedicated socialists in America were Europeans importing socialist traditions from their home countries. It's no surprise that socialism tended to be strongest in immigrant communities, among Germans, Scandinavians, and Finns in the Midwest, and among Jewish immigrants in New York. And all of these difficulties in building a broad-reaching socialist coalition were compounded by the structure of American politics. Even today, think about how many times you've seen a friend on social media begging people not to vote third party because it will take away votes from another candidate. And this difficulty was made worse by the brutal repression of socialists. Violence by state troops and private police forces against unions in the 19th and 20th centuries, the first Red Scare of 1919 to 1920, which saw many radicals jailed or deported, and then the second Red Scare of the 1950s, which saw socialists and communists blacklisted and fired. Even now, people who consider themselves communists are banned from immigrating to the United States. But the question isn't really why America never became a socialist country. After all, neither did any of those European countries. The real question is why, after the Democratic Party briefly became a social democratic party in the 1930s and 40s, America has been without any party pushing not just socialism, but any sort of redistribution to help ordinary people. That is the most bizarre absent feature of America. But of course, history isn't destiny. Denied opportunity their whole lives, forced into dead-end jobs, facing mountains of debt and grim prospects, more and more Americans, especially young ones, are identifying as socialists. Socialism never took root in America before, but that doesn't mean it can't now. This is Emma Vigeland for the Gravel Institute.